I'm going to introduce you to our presenter and trainer today, Greg Archer. Hello, Greg. Welcome. Greg's been involved in English language teaching since 2010. He's managed the English language department at an international language college. He's also developed courses for pre-university study for CLIL, and teaching English for academic purposes. And he's also taught lots of exam classes. So he's got lots of experience and knowledge to share with us on the topic today. At the moment, Greg is an author, he's a teacher, he's a teacher trainer, and he also writes official test papers for IELTS and Cambridge exams. So we're delighted to have you with us, Greg. Thanks very much. And I will hand them over to you. See you at the end for some questions.
Good. Thank you, Danya. Thank you, everybody, for coming. You catch us here in Cambridge, and it's been an absolutely beautiful sunny day. I know that probably means very little to so many of you who are used to this kind of thing in most days of your life, but to us, it's so important here in England that we've had a beautiful, warm, sunny day. So everybody's mood is absolutely flying. Again, but thank you. Thank you for coming along. Thank you for giving up your time to join me here today talking about developing speaking skills for B1 preliminary and B2 first. As Donya said, this is the last webinar in our series. Hopefully you've caught some of the others that have been in the series. They are extremely useful, and I would heartily recommend it. If you haven't, then you go back and have a look at those as well to really build up your kind of package of wonderful advice and everything else that comes with these things. I'm going to be talking about teaching grammar and vocabulary today. Very often, I think when I speak to language teachers, and particularly language teachers who haven't been teaching for a hugely long time, I think a lot of us feel just kind of safe. There's a safety in teaching grammar and vocabulary. It's what we do, we're language teachers, and it's kind of what the point of our job and our vocation is. But I think it's important really to that we differentiate that grammar and vocabulary teaching is not the same as grammar and vocabulary teaching it for speaking. There is a difference between presentation of grammar and that sort of thing, and understanding and working through that, and actually bringing it into students' active speaking skills. So what are we going to be doing today? Well, here's what we're going to be looking at. I'm going to be looking at how, first of all, just a run-through of, you may know this already or be slightly familiar with it, but just a brief run-through of how grammar and a vocabulary is assessed. In the B1 preliminary and B2 first exams. What I'm going to be talking about in terms of teaching the grammar and vocabulary for speaking, it's not exclusive to these exams. Okay, these are skills that are perfectly that are really transferable to any aspect of speaking and speaking for life skills and that sort of thing. But this is we're doing it within this framework today. And I know that many of you will be teaching students towards these exams. We're going to be looking at how to raise awareness of grammar and vocabulary use. Okay, so not the rules of grammar and vocabulary and presentation of how to teach grammar and vocabulary, but how to help students to use that in their speaking. And the important thing is enabling them to upgrade their existing language and their use of that language. And this word upgrade, hopefully by the end of this webinar, I'll have explained how important this word is to me and my teaching, this idea of upgrading language. So that's what we're up to. Let's move on to the first thing I want to do here is this is a question that comes from the B2 first four exams. It's a question from part four of the speaking test. And it's, do you think it's better to go out and do things after school, or is it better to stay at home? Now, I'm going to show you probably saw them jump up on the screen there. I'm going to show you three beginnings, A, B, and C, three beginnings to an answer to this question. Okay, what I would like you to do, okay, and everybody, if you could just put into the chat box Which of the three beginnings, A, B, or C, do you think is most likely to gain the most credit from the examiner in the B2 exam, the speaking examiner, in the first for schools exam? Okay, so I'm going to put the three up. Which one is most likely to gain credit from the examiner? Is it A, B, or C? And I'll give you a moment to read them. And once you've read them, can you just put into the chat box whether you think A, B, or C is most preferable in terms of what the examiner would appreciate? Okay, mostly C's. I think mostly people are saying C. We've got quite a few B's coming through. Remember, of course, you can't see everybody else's. I'm just giving you a summary. But it's a split. There's an even split here between B's and C's. Okay, thank you. You don't need to add any more. We got the odd A coming through there as well. Right. I'm not going to tell you just now, because before I tell you, we will come back to that in a moment, but let's focus on the teacher's handbooks. I just want to focus on the teacher's handbooks for both preliminary and first, and consider the marking criteria for grammar and vocabulary in the speaking part of the exam. If you don't have these already, then these are really, really, really useful resources to have. They are free from Cambridge, and they are downloadable online, and they're extremely useful, not least because they set out some of the criteria that the examiners use when assessing speaking. So let's focus on the grammar aspect of this first of all. At B1 level, we can essentially see that the main drive here is about control of simple grammatical forms. It's not about much more than that. B1 level is not about much more than that until we're looking at the more capable students and candidates at level 5. And at the higher end, the examiner is expecting to hear the student to attempt some complex grammatical forms, but not expecting too much, obviously. So this is how it works in the preliminary B1. If we look at B2, essentially the same criteria are transposed across. Okay, so 5 goes to 3, 3 goes to 1. The highest score of 5 at B2 level now requires, as you can see, a good degree of control of a range of simple and some complex grammatical forms. So we can see that at that end, the examiner is expecting to hear a little more. And these are important words: range, simple, complex, and control. Excuse me. So let's have a look and have a quick think. Can you back to the chat box if we could. What is simple grammar and what is complex grammar? Can you just in the chat box, how would you answer each of these questions? What is simple grammar and what is complex grammar? If a student asks you these questions, what would you say? So simple grammar is basic rules, subject, verb, noun, simple sentences. Complex conditionals are example of complex, simple sentences, basic chatty complex writing, basic rules, basic structure. Okay, I think we know what it is. I think we should know really what it is. Your students might not necessarily, but obviously this is the thing, and we do. And this is from the handbook, and we would get here and we would know that simple grammatical forms. I'm not going to read all of this while you read along, because I think it could be quite annoying when you're reading something and somebody is reading it as well. I'm not going to do that. It's in the handbook if you need to refer to it. But at the most essential level, simple grammar is if your student, for example, comes in and says this: I did my homework at the weekend, I forgot it today, I'm sorry about that. And in an upgrade of that language, then perhaps a complex way of saying that might have been, although I did my homework at the weekend, I've forgotten to bring it to you today, I would love it if you could forgive me for that. Clearly, if you have a student in your B1 preliminary class who comes in and says something like the second example there, then you'd forgive them, because They're probably above doing that anyway, and they should be moved to a new class. But this is the kind of idea, and we know what we're looking for, but students don't necessarily understand what they are. So let's go on and look at this idea of vocabulary. Let's focus on vocab. Again, here's the criteria for B1. And here we've got the term, a range of appropriate vocabulary. Okay, and it can be at the lower end, a limited range, a range of appropriate vocabulary. And again, these criteria, they transpose over to B2 level. And it's B2 level, it's level, at high score of 5, it's now looking at still a range of appropriate vocabulary, but it widens out what the expectation, a wide range of familiar topics. Okay. What's appropriate vocabulary? What does this word actually mean? Because certainly at B1 level and possibly B2, the word appropriate may seem a little bit vague, and then the students might not understand. Well, again, going back to the handbook, it's this, the use of words and phrases that fit context of the given task. For example, today's strong rain and heavy wind makes it difficult to get around the city. This is partly appropriate. Makes it difficult to get around the city is kind of, it's clear, it's conversational, there's a nice phrasal verb there. But today's strong rain and heavy wind, that doesn't work, strong rain and heavy wind. So it's kind of, at this level, that's what the examiner is thinking, is that appropriate language? Because what we're looking at as well, in teaching our students to have a range of vocabulary, are things like fixed phrases, collocations, like we see in this example here. It should be heavy rain and strong wind, and this person's got them the wrong way around, and it sounds strange. But collocations, grammatical forms is in there because this definition from the glossary of the handbook doesn't differentiate there. The range is about the full range of grammar and vocabulary. So how can we upgrade a student's language? So most of my classmates use their iPhones to watch movies online. It's perfectly correct. But thinking about this idea of devices instead of iPhones and stream online content instead of watch movies online, there's a difference in appropriacy and what's the range of vocabulary that's being used there. Now let's go back to this. We're going to go back to these term beginnings from a moment ago, and I want us to think about how the language that is being used might be interpreted by the examiner. First of all, a lot of people said that B, the examiner, would hear this and think, yep, that's the best option. I would say not. For me, certainly, this sounds a little bit unnatural. Okay, it's more like written English than spoken English. So we have a problem with appropriacy here. Nowadays, many people believe that children must know the dangers outside of their home. It sounds kind of like a newsreader or someone from Downton Abbey. It doesn't sound quite natural. There's an unclear use of children must know the dangers. Well, which meaning of must? And the linkers aren't, again, quite there. They're not really true of spoken English. And in fact, my students will often say that B is the best answer, and it's perfectly understandable, because perhaps we're teaching them this, that the idea of written English is the best English. I don't think it's necessarily about the English language. I think that's true of a lot of languages, that written language is the higher example of language use. But I would say no, this is not the examiner. I certainly think it sounds a bit weird. See, that's okay. It's a bit basic, though. It's got control of basic forms, which is good for B1 level. But again, we're teachers. We want to push our students forward. There's control of simple sentences, but that's not a lot more than this. And there's not a clear range of grammatical forms. The use of boring is the wrong form. I'm bored at home, it should be. And there's repetition. Want to see my friends. That's not necessarily a bad thing, because we do that while we're speaking, but it doesn't show a range of vocabulary. I think it's very interesting, because this, for me, absolutely clearly, and when I've gone through this many times with my high school age students, most of them think that A is the worst answer of the three. And this is a great way of showing them that that is absolutely not the case, because they think, oh, this person keeps saying and like and I mean, and it's too informal. And this is a good way, please feel free to kind of to use this in your class to show them that this is how natural speech works, and examiners aren't there making ticking off the number of times they say There are some really good examples of more advanced language use here. It could well be preferable to go out, preferable rather than better. Young people have had to stay. That's not a basic verb form. And over the past couple of years is an example of nice conversational English. It is appropriate. Okay. So of the three, A is the best. It really is. And this is a nice way of raising students' confidence that they don't have to be concentrating on trying not to say or like. And then when they do that, they can concentrate instead on using the grammar, the vocabulary and the grammar better, more expressively. One thing before we go on, I'd just like to go back. If you're teaching B1 preliminary, this is from number five. This is the top grade for preliminary. The word attempts is really important here, because it shows us that trying to use attempting to use more complex grammatical forms is preferable to always playing it safe with simple grammar. Even though your simple words might be entirely correct. So the advice to your students is, look, it doesn't matter if it's not absolutely right. The examiner will recognize what you're doing, that you're trying, and they will give you credit for this. Okay. And I often find that they feel more confident, and it addresses their fear of saying something incorrectly. If they're trying to stretch themselves and their language ability, making mistakes is fine. Okay, so how do we encourage our students to develop their use of grammar and vocabulary? Often they kind of know a word or phrase when they read it, or they might recognize it, or they can figure it out in reading it. Or they can complete the gap fill exercises all correctly, but do they actually use it when they speak? Do they use it when they speak? And often the answer is no. So what should we be doing as teachers to help them move a language from the passive, something that is passive language, that they understand and know, move it to something from their passive to their active language? And this is the thing that we are trying to do. They may know the grammar, they may understand it, but putting it up to active vocabulary and grammar is the key. So we're going to look at some practical activities. These are all things that I've done in class in the past and I have found successful. I've come to this point after making mistakes, but I think these are all generally tend to be effective. So first of all, the B1 preliminary from schools. Teachers all around the world use sample exam papers. It's very common everywhere, but often teachers, we use sample papers just to give students practice for the exam. And I actually like to use sample papers as a starting point from which to develop language. Okay, not a means of testing it or giving it practice in the times practice in the exam, but actually developing language from it. And the following, what we're going to do here, this really reflects what I think is a good, effective model of classroom teaching, where the classroom isn't somewhere that we go to correct students' mistakes. Okay, so for example, the idea of going around and listening to students and writing down what they're saying, and then going to the board at the end of class or next stage and saying, well, this wasn't quite right. How can we improve this? There is a place for that, absolutely, but I see classes as more a place to actively upgrade the language that students are producing at that moment rather than pure correction. So we're going to look at part two of the speaking exam in B1 preliminary, and this is where the candidates are given, the examiner says that they'd like each candidate to talk about on their own about something, and they get a photograph to talk about. And this example of someone learning how to do something is this is what candidate A would get, and candidate B would get this. Okay. please tell us what you can see in the photograph. This is the instruction that the examiner gives the candidate. And this is some advice from the teacher's handbook. Okay, it recommends one way in which students should approach the task. They should imagine they're describing the photograph to someone who can't see it, could name all the objects, describing colours, however it might be. Okay, so what we're going to do here is we are all going to go through this activity in the same way that I would do it in class. Okay, here's what we're going to do. I am going to give everybody all around the world 20 seconds, and I want you all to work together to compile a list. Okay, in the chat box, a list. You won't see the list, I will. A list of all the items that you can see in this picture. All right, so basically name everything that you can see. So in the chat box, I'm going to start timing 20 seconds. Go. Okay, so we got a woman, tiny kid, there are two people, cabinet, baking, kitchen, stove, cooker, table, two people, recipe, etchers. Whoa, my goodness, this is the longest list. People talking, table, chairs, baking, recipe, but good. I know you can't see all this. brilliant. Okay, thank you. Stop. My goodness, wonderful. That's great. Thank you for all of your ideas, kitchen, eggs, table, mother and daughter making breakfast. Okay, so this is the way that basically we would do it in class. Okay, I split the students into two or three or four groups. They all come to the board or to the whiteboard. Each group has one pen and they're in a line and they hand it back to the person behind them. Each group takes it in turns to write a word, write a vocabulary item, something that they can see. And the idea, the principle here is to create a live vocab list under time pressure. Okay, so it might run something like this. They'll say, okay, team one, yeah, okay, flour, okay, team two, yeah, edge, pass the pen back, good, cooker, what else you got? Team two, oven, okay, table, good, team one, what you got? Cupboards, teapot, okay, and it goes on like this, okay, until basically the time's elapsed or they've run out of vocab. Now, when they've done this at the end, just take a moment and look at what they've got together and ask them which vocabulary, which words or lexical items they think are kind of high level vocab. And in this list that I've given you here, scales is probably the least common, least basic item and something the most likely to catch the examiner's ear. But the main thing here is that this is a useful opportunity for you to upgrade their language before they actually do the task. For example, so you always try and elicit the language from them, obviously. Okay, so we've got, what's the word for, we've got cooker and oven, but what's the word for that flat surface with the flames on top of the oven where you put the pots? What's that called? Okay, that's called a hob. In British English, it's called a hob. American English is stovetop. Table's okay, quite a basic word. What's behind, what's over the back? There's sideboard, work surface. And basically you are giving them slightly higher level of language, slightly a wider range. This is it, a wider range of vocabulary. And as I say, try and elicit the vocabulary. So for example, in the chat box, what is the word that they are using for these wooden items, the wooden spoon? I think a couple of people said, what's the word that you wouldn't speak? You utensils. Yes, exactly, utensils. So you're always kind of trying to elicit and you're improving their range of vocabulary. And then you get them to go back and sit down, and they sit down, and as they're going back to sit down and being sort of high school age students, their brains will often immediately go, okay, we've done that, what's the next thing we're doing? And it will go out of their head, and then you're busy at that point rubbing all the new vocabulary off the board and say, right, in pairs, what words did we have for this? And this is it. It's the idea of improving vocabulary. It's about kind of reviewing and recycling and as many opportunities to see this vocabulary as possible, to get it from passive to active. So this is one thing to start with. Now, I mentioned a moment ago that scales, kitchen scales, was likely to be the least common word that they came up with. It's very simple. You can check the general level of any item of vocabulary by going to the online Cambridge Dictionary. Not every word in the world, but you will often find the level. In this case, kitchen scales is B2, and that's the level that you would most commonly expect the word to be used. Okay, it doesn't mean that if it's at B2 level, you shouldn't teach it to B1 students. If anything, it's the opposite, because it can give B1 students a bit of confidence to be able to produce something that is in the exam above they're doing, or in the level they're above that what they're doing. And it's just there. Okay. Sometimes students might forget the name for something, even if you've done all this work in upgrading the language. But particularly if it's, we're talking about the exam and you know, that they do put pressure on themselves. So a question to you, and again in the chat box, yes or no, would the candidate lose credit from the examiner if they can't remember the right word in English and they say this, for example? Would they be penalised by the examiner? And if so, no. Okay, most of you, the vast majority of you, yes. The answer is no. They will not lose credit whatsoever, not at all, for forgetting the word in English. I mean, I've spoken English all my life. Sometimes I forget what the name of something. I forget words increasingly as I get older. I forget words, but it's how you compensate for that. It's how you deal with it, and we do it. We all do it in our first language as well. And if we look at this idiomatic, if we look at this, it says again from the handbook, they'll be given credit if they use paraphrase or other strategies. And I think someone mentioned, yeah, there is a good use of paraphrase, and there is. If you have a B1 student who says, for some reason, my mind's gone blank, I guarantee you that the examiner will think, okay, this is really nice use of vocabulary. And even if it's not examiner, it is really nice use of a fixed phrase that kind of people use when their mind's gone blank. So it's good to teach them this. It's good to teach them these phrases as well, not just in the sense of managing the discourse, but because it shows off a good range of good control of language. And there's that word again, about control. And this is also from the teacher's handbook. Spoken language often involves false starts where you say some incomplete utterances, ellipsis where you kind of, you know, when you sort of, yeah, and reformulation, which this is here, and where communication is achieved, they're not penalized. So another thing not to worry about for them. Don't worry about this. Don't worry about saying, stopping yourself saying and ah. It's fine. It's what we do when we speak. Here's the second picture from part two. So just think for a moment about, if you saw this, what we want to try and do is get students to a point where they're not just naming everything they can see, but they are actively thinking, what words do I know that is probably the highest level of vocabulary in this picture? And looking at this picture now, this is just a quick list that I put together. Which of these words do you think, the chat box, which of these vocabulary items is the highest level? Ornaments. Yeah, ornaments is it feels right. It feels like it's higher level. There's another example here of leather sofa, of bringing in adjectives to kind of enhance the description. But ornament, definitely. But this is vocabulary again. We're focusing on vocabulary again here. What about grammar? How can we encourage students to produce more complex forms or structures in the exam? Well, the backup prompts are there on the paper that they're given. And it's quite simple. Talk about the person, the place, other things. But what about these? What's the boy doing? He's supporting his team. Now, often students, if you ask what is the boy doing or what's happening in the picture, it's perfectly natural to come to reply with something. He's supporting his team. He is at home, or something like that. It's more difficult to produce a range of of grammar forms immediately, because you're naturally being asked, what is happening? Where is he? So it's kind of pushing the students to think about, how can we use other verb forms? Maybe get them to think about the decision that the person in the picture has taken. He's turned on the TV to watch a football match. He's sat down to watch. So another one, he'll be watching until the end of the match. So it's kind of, okay, now we've got a wider range. And remember, it doesn't have to be the most perceptive observation. You know, the match hasn't finished yet. Well, obviously, because it's still on the TV. That's not the point. But what you're doing is, it might be entirely obvious what's happening, but it's a good chance to show a range of language, a range of grammar. And even adding one or two verb forms just other than present simple or present progressive or continuous, that allows the students to show off a greater range of grammar. And the way that I do it in class is that I get students to know this as shorthand. My students know I have will. Say I have will to them, they know what I mean. And it's basically an exercise where they kind of build their ability to use a wider range of grammar. So it's basically what is happening, what has happened, what will, might, could happen. It does encourage differentiation here, because obviously stronger students may be able to use a wider range of modals, and like might and could, and even lexical chunks for prediction, like I wouldn't be surprised if, it's likely that. But it also gives support to the less able students who will think, right, I can use will here or I can try and use have. So in this situation, what could we possibly say? I have will. Let's have a look at this. Okay, they're following a recipe. The woman is leaning on the table. She's helping her to. The girl's cracked an egg into that. They have only just started. They've decided to have pasta for dinner. Okay. Just these small things, and this is the thing. Upgrading is often about just small things that raise the level. What happened just before the photo was taken? We've got a suggestion from Paul here. What happened just before the photo was taken? What have they decided? Why have they decided to do this? And often what I will do is I'll get a photograph on the board. It doesn't have to be from an exam, any photograph on the board of people doing something. And I'll say to the students, often as a warmer activity at the start of class, okay, everybody in pairs, can you do three R have wills each? Work together. And it builds their ability to see the grammar before. And if they can see what opportunities to use it before they start, then they are more able to use the active language. That grammar becomes part of their active language. So let's move on to it. Yes. Okay. So we're going to have a look at Roberto and Simone. If you've seen the previous webinars in the series, then I'm sure you will have seen part of this test before. That's fine. And I often show students the same part of a speaking test in class, but I get them to focus on different things. You know, it might be the way that they are extending their answers or their discourse management or their turn taking. But this, we are focusing only on grammar and vocabulary. Okay, so as I'm going to play this, and as you watch and listen to Simone, can you just have a think about these five questions? Is his use of grammar accurate? Control over simple grammar? Does he attempt more complex? Is it appropriate vocabulary? And is there a range of it? Okay, so I'll play it, and when I press stop at the end of his term, please just give me your answers to these questions.
Simone, here is your photograph. It shows someone at home after school. Roberto, you just listen. Simone, please tell us what you can see in the photograph.
So in the photograph, I can see a boy who is watching a football match. Probably his favorite football team is playing right now. He's alone at home because nobody is sitting next to him. He's in his living room, probably. He's wearing trousers and a shirt, a white shirt. There is a table in the middle of the living room. And on the table, there are some cards, a candle, a pen, papers. I think he's having a really good time because I think he really likes watching football team playing.
What do we think? Are, have we got all yeses? Are there any noes? Yes to all fire control grammar. Yes, no. There's yep. There's a lot of yeses here. There are a lot of yeses. And I, if Simone was my B1 student, I would be very pleased. He's a good student at that level. Absolutely. Let's have a look at what the examiner said. The examiner's comments here, and the examiner says he uses appropriate vocabulary to talk about, and his grammatical structures are all accurate and show a good range. This is good. Can we make it better? Is there a way to make it better, however? So this is a transcript of what Simone said. All of this stuff is available on YouTube, including the transcript. So it's really useful to think about how you can use this in class. This is a transcript of what Simone said. Now, let's focus on the grammar and vocabulary. It is correct. It's good. It's appropriate. But how could he consider using a wider range of each? Okay. Now, I give this transcript to students and I say, let's think about how this Simone could have upgraded this. And I'll give them an example. So for the first sentence, remember what we've focused on about context and a decision that has made or the boy's recent action. So we could say, for example, in the photograph, I could see a boy who sat down to watch a football match or who has sat down to watch a football match. Again, upgrading. In the next sentence, we could get to he's in his living room probably, or I'd imagine. Vocabulary. Now we've got vocabulary going on, and the table in the middle of the room, and on the table someone has put some cards, someone has left. If you're really high level students, even there's some cards, a candle and pen have been left on the table, and that, that's really kind of pushing it. Someone has left some cards, a candle, pen, papers, plus a couple of remotes and ornaments. Remember back to the vocab list we just looked at here. And now we have a turn that is improved on Simone's, which was really good. There's a wider range of grammar and vocabulary. The important thing is we haven't really changed much. We haven't changed everything. It's just a couple of adaptations and additions, thinking about the way of using and the way that people do use grammar. We don't think about, I'm going to use the present perfect here because it's a situation that has just fit. We use them. And if you show students context for use of grammar, I think that can be so much more helpful than explaining a grammar rule. Let's look at part two of the B2 first exam. Now, the task is different here. As many of you know, they have two pictures to talk about instead of one. And the question asks them to speculate. This is where the language level, the demand goes up, because they speculate and they guess what's happening in the pictures and how the people in the pictures feel, or what might they have done, or and they make comparisons between the two. Now, if you keep in mind the process of upgrading your students' language, and your students, if they understand that this is the principle that you work through in your class. Here's an example of what I've done previously, and this basically involved, I get students to not necessarily everybody in the class if you've got a huge class, but you take it in turns with two or three students at a time. And the transcript that I put up on the board is a transcript of one section of one of my students' turns. Okay, and we put this up, and I will give my students a little sheet of paper with this transcript on. And I say, this is good. This is a good turn. In pairs and threes, let's think about how we can upgrade this. I mean, this is good use of grammar. So how can you improve this language? And here's a really nice activity. Okay, so they talk about what they think first. But I tell the students, okay, this is your transcript here. I want you to read it and listen. Okay, I'm going to read this out and you listen as I read it. However, I'm not going to say exactly the same thing that is on the transcript. Okay, some of the text is different from what you will hear. All right, I'll read it first time. The first time I want you to underline the parts of this transcript, the words and phrases that you hear that are different. Okay, so underline them in the original text where they're not the same that I say. And then I'll say it again and again. Okay, So here's I'll just show you this because we're kind of moving on and running short of time. So I'm not going to go to the chat box here. But the principle is this. Okay, so you imagine you're a student with your pen ready to underline. The guy at the back has already fallen behind. Perhaps he's pretty out of shape, or maybe he really hates athletics. So it's especially difficult for him to motivate himself to take part. I imagine that because the girl in the middle is way taller than the others, everyone else is at a disadvantage. Despite this, the girl on the left of the picture is really pushing herself to win. Okay. So that's their task. They have to underline. Where do they hear differences initially? And they will kind of, they hopefully will have underlined that. And then you read it again. And I try to read it sort of three times in total, maybe four, so that they can write down the upgraded language that I'm feeding into them. Okay, just to show them that the next part above. And then they check together and they try and figure out what was said. And then eventually I will give them what they heard. Okay, and we can clarify a meaning at that point anyway. And it's a great way to get students to notice language that is currently above what they produce. Okay, and this is your job as the teacher to scaffold them and feed this language in. They have a context. They understand the meaning of what is being said because they've tried it already. And you're just providing that scaffolding to help them improve. And as I said earlier, it's about reviewing and recycling the language all the time. So next class, maybe give them this. Again, as a warmer, it could be a warmer activity or just go back at some stage in your class, or you can show it on the board. And you get them to read it aloud with a partner. But they have to manipulate the text as they read it. They have to say not what is in the text. They have to say what the vocabulary was instead. Okay, and it's really kind of engaging their working memory to try and move something from passive to active language. If you've got more capable students, you could do this. Just give them the vocabulary that you taught and get them to construct the turn around this vocabulary again. But this is the thing, you've got the principle of upgrading, then there's so many different ways that you can use it. Because ultimately it is all about practice. This is the most important stage in all of this. And we language teachers, and I'm not immune to this at all, we can get carried away with kind of explaining and presenting language, especially if it's for the first time or introducing a new point. But we can put all the time in the world into showing them this and getting them to write it down and doing and gap fill exercises, fine. But it will be for nothing if we want them to learn grammar and vocabulary for speaking rather than just grammar and vocabulary. We need to give them a chance to recycle the language and practice it. This is from the handbook again. Of course, it's an idea that I know many of you use. They record and listen to themselves to see how they're doing and they improve. But if they've got this idea of upgrading language, they can go back to what they've recorded and then actively kind of think about how they could improve it and go to you for help, come to you for help. It doesn't have to be from sample papers or exam activities. This is from a course book called Prepare Level 7. These photos aren't part of a structured speaking activity. They just happen to be on a page, but they're quite nice. You know, they're just really nice. What's happening in here? And you could instruct your students to swap pictures with classmates as well. You know, it doesn't have to be what's in the course book. And of course, there's all sorts of technology to help this along. You know, you've got apps like Voice Spice where students can record themselves speaking, save it and send it if they're working on a laptop. They might just prefer to send a WhatsApp message. That's how people use the phones these days. That doesn't happen anymore. I know I'm getting old. And also Google Voice typing provides a written dictation of what they say. So they can send each other audio files and upgrade those. Or one idea that I work with in class often is a student uses Google Voice and Google Voice takes the dictation and the student sends not the audio recording of themselves, but they send the transcript to a classmate. And that classmate has to look at the transcript, think about how to upgrade it, and then record the improved turn and send it back to the to student A. So student A sends the text to student B sends back an audio recording. And they're working together to kind of upgrade the language together. It's kind of a joint way of doing it. So the student A would eventually get a recording back and they would have to correct or upgrade the language in their original turn. And then they can record themselves doing it again and compare the first one and the second one. And it can be really, really empowering for students to see improvement occurring, especially with through collaboration. There we go. This is another way of using an activity, part three from the B2 first exam. And what I would do is I'd ask the student, I'd give the students time to prepare what they're going to say. So I ask them a question, why might students want to speak another language? Okay. And preparation time is hugely beneficial. Okay. We can't expect students to produce amazing language spontaneously, particularly not new language that you've just highlighted. So the more they practice planning that language, the more they're engaging with it. And in this exercise, I basically give them a single question that's from the part three diagram and in pairs they brainstorm vocabulary and consider how to incorporate a wider range of grammar and prompt them if they need help. So, you know, if someone knows another language well, they can work in other countries. So how can we, if someone has studied another language, they might be able to get good jobs. This is lovely to do in class because you're listening to them as they're using the language and you're just there upgrading as it's happening. And a good way to adapt it is to give them this. You blank out two of the prompts on a diagram, and on the other diagram, you give one student A gets one diagram, student B gets the other. So they have different options blanked out. So this is a nice way to kind of use a prepared turn and spontaneous language and planned language. This is where it works together because student A in the top right will have planned and prepared some ideas and vocabulary of talking about playing a musical instrument. And when they talk to student B, you can see that one isn't there. So they have to be more spontaneous. And it's about thinking on their feet while at the same time being able to plan the language. And you can go back to vocabulary just in the chat box. Can anybody remember the vocabulary from earlier on? If you don't have any interests outside of school, you might be what when the time comes to apply for university? You might be at what? What might you be? You might be at a, anybody? Okay, at a disadvantage. Right, yeah. So you are then recycling vocabulary and grammar all the time for them, all the time. Some students find it hard to what at school, especially if they keep in their study. So they might want to start exploring, motivate themselves. Thank you. Especially if they keep what in their studies. So if they keep getting worse, they keep falling behind in their study. So you are constantly kind of giving them help. One other idea is to take from a course book. And when these chunks, these lexical chunks that you've used for the function of introducing an opinion, I find something like this, to give students something like this is really good with the main parts of the words blanked out, but they have to converse with each other and use the phrases as they should be. Like in my eyes, you could be right as far as I'm concerned. And it's about practicing, but also getting them to go into their memories and activate that language. This is an example from a slightly higher level that I use. I give them the words, the phrases that we've done in class, but they also fill in the gaps as well. And they choose which vocabulary they're going to think about. And this is something I scanned from class of all these phrases that the students added. You can see the G's and A's. And the idea is that G, Gabriel, once he said that, then A, Anna couldn't use it. So it's kind of like bingo, and they accumulate as many as they possibly can in their talk. They can choose any vocabulary that they want as long as it's related to the class over the past few months. It's the new language that needs to be activated. But yeah, give them a bit of freedom with it. So there are also self-study activities that are really, really useful. And that's on the Cambridge English website. The preparing for exams on there. The link will be links here at the end. You can go back to it. So essentially, we've gone through grammar and vocabulary, the assessment criteria, how to kind of build and raise awareness, but importantly, upgrading language is looking for improvements, not mistakes. Thank you. Donya's just put the self-study lesson plan link on the chat box. Recycle, review, revisit language. Don't just show that you can't learn an item of vocabulary or anything is in isolation. You need to keep going back. And most importantly, give them practice. They need the practice and be there while they're practicing to encourage and even to upgrade even more. Thank you for coming. I know that many of you have got to go back to teaching now, or you are in the middle of something. But if you do want to get in touch, then please send me a connection request on LinkedIn. But yes, thank you very, very much for coming. If there are any questions, then I'll be happy to take them in the remaining 7 or 8 minutes that we have. But thank you.
Thank you very much, Greg. Some really practical, useful classroom activities that teachers can take away and try right away. So that's fantastic. If you have any specific questions, now is the time to post them in the Q&A box. We have a few here already.
Yeah.
So one teacher has asked, how important, Greg, is it for students to be familiar with the rubrics that they're going to be assessed on for the exam?
I think it is. I mean, I say this quite often because from my teaching experience as someone who was in a high school, it really helps them. All of the teachers of their academic subjects took a really long time to establish with their students, right, in this part of the exam, this is the first question is a definition. You get 2 marks for that. In the second question, that's worth 15 marks. You have to do X, Y, and Z. And they were really kind of clued up and they knew what they had to do in their economics exam, for example. And I think as language teachers, we often kind of feel, not entirely confident, not confident. It's just we feel as if we give them too much instruction. And we know that languages are learned through acquisition and practice. And if you set out too explicitly the way that you move from this to this, as you would do in an academic subject, then it might feel a little bit uncomfortable. But I would actually say it's really important that the students know what they're going to expect in the exam. So the rubric is part of this. And it's not something that they will be strange to them. They will be used to it in all their other subjects because their other subject teachers will be drumming it into them. This is what you have to do. So, yes, good question. I think, yeah, definitely for me.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. And we've had a few questions, actually, on a similar topic about memorising new vocabulary. Do you have any tips for helping students to remember new vocabulary?
Well, the main one is practice. The main one is practice, and it's about practicing as well in a context that is either completely meaningful for them, or if it's not meaningful, it's familiar. One other way of doing it that I've found very, very useful is giving them a completely strange and bizarre context that is kind of either, you know, it's just ridiculous or funny. And if you can do that with them. But number one, the main thing is practice. And that's not doesn't mean showing them again and again. It's getting them together. Saying the vocabulary helps. The more times it's repeated, the more chance it's got from moving from your immediate working memory to your longer term memory. It's the way that the memory works. It's really, really interesting. But I often kind of get students to take a moment once we've got some new vocabulary. It's we've worked on the pronunciation, and I just get them to sit there for a moment or two, even if they don't use their voice, they're kind of mouthing it or saying it, aspirating it as they're reading it. It depends on how they feel comfortable. They could be looking at pictures of something, but it's an individual's choice, really. But it's that kind of recycle, recycle, recycle. And in something that becomes memorable. There's no short answer to that.
So I've taken from that, I suppose, recycling and just using the language again and again in different contexts and different ways.
Yeah, absolutely.
Get it
further in their memory. Say it to yourself as much as possible, because the more you do, then the more it stays in your the more chance you've got that it will move into long-term memory. And if it is in long-term memory, you've got more chance of accessing it to move it from passive to active. So it's kind of like a backward and forward process between showing them, goes into long-term memory, and then you've got to help them get it out again. And it only comes from kind of engaging with use.
On the topic of vocabulary, actually, we have a webinar which is focusing just on teaching and developing vocabulary in May. So that's on the website now. So if that is a topic that you're particularly interested in and want to find out more, do have a look at our website. We have a new booklet which is about teaching vocabulary. So I'll put that in the chat box now as well, just before we go.
There is also another webinar I did about FIRST, not for schools, but for B2 FIRST, which is available online. And there's some suggestions there for you know, vocabulary activities that are not necessarily, you know, it's not just because it's not for schools. They are still appropriate. So that would be something to look at as well, if you want to access that.
Great. Okay, let's see if we have one final question. Oh, I've lost the Q&A box. A couple of teachers have asked, actually, Greg, would you mind just re-explaining how to play that bingo game that you did at the end?
Yes, yeah, I'm not, yeah, sorry, that was a little bit rushed. I could share the screen, couldn't I? Let's go back to that. Hopefully everyone can see.
Yeah, we can see questions.
Yeah. Okay. Don't. Yeah. So basically, you work from it. You get the once you've practiced this in class, you've done these. You've worked with the students, so they recognise these vocabulary, these lexical chunks, and then you put them on a grid. Okay, but you don't put the whole thing on a grid. And when they're working in pairs or threes and they're doing a speaking activity, they don't fill in the gaps. They just use these as prompts to remind themselves what it could be. So in my eyes is the first one. You could be right, as far as I'm concerned, I guess. And these are all kind of phrases that you've worked with in class. If you've been focusing in class on kind of that interactive part of, well, just having a chat, really. This is the kind of thing that I might give to a B1 class. This is for a higher level. And this is what I did actually for a very, very good B2 class once. And that I gave them a bigger grid with all these fixed phrases and vocabulary that we'd worked on in class together. And then I said to them, okay, you've got to fill in the rest of the gaps with other stuff that we've done in class. And they came up with, you know, by and large and give and take. We looked at these, we'd been looking at, binomial, first and foremost, by and large, these sort of things. And this was Anna and Gabrielle. And once the student has used one of those phrases, they put their initial on it and it's out of the game. Okay, it's like crossing a number out of bingo. And they basically have to try and fill out the grid. So once one student has used one of those things, you can see that some way down, Gabriel and Anna, on having said that, Gabriel's tried to claim it, even though he's not allowed to because Anna was there originally. But it's a nice way of kind of gamifying practice of vocabulary. And I find it generally works, and they get a little bit competitive about who ends up with the most initials on the grid. So it's a really nice idea. I use it in class a lot.
Brilliant. Yeah, that looks like a really, really fun and engaging way to get students to practice all that language.
Yeah, it's all about practice.
There we go. One thing to take away, practice, practice, practice. You can't get away from it. There's no shortcuts, unfortunately. Okay, well, I think we're out of time. Thank you so much, Greg, for
your time, everyone.
And all your knowledge that you've shared with us. And thank you to all the teachers for joining us and for participating so enthusiastically. We hope that we'll see you soon for our next webinar. And have a brilliant week, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.